everyone. I'm Christine Young, one of your pastors on staff here at Lake Deaton United Methodist Church, and I'd like to welcome you to my home and to Lake Deaton at home. We are so glad that you've joined us today, and we'd ask that you would please take a moment sometime during our service or after the service to sign our online connection pad. You can find this on our Lake Deaton at Home website at www.lakedeatonathome.com. This Monday, you will receive an email survey to help us make Lake Deaton at Home better. Please, if you are able, we do ask that you take a few minutes to fill that out and send it back to us to give us feedback so we can make this service better for you. I also wanted to let you know that on August 29th, if you live in the Tri-County area of Central Florida, that's Lake, Marion, and Sumter counties, we'll be having an in-person healing service at 3 p.m. We've also wrapped up our summer grow night, but that means fall grow night is right around the corner. In fact, you can already sign up for our kickoff dinner, which will be held on Wednesday, September 8th at 5 p.m. Again, this is a great in-person event. However, we will post the program on our grow page of our website the following days for those of you who are not local. Our program that evening will include an update on our vision, mission, and core values that we've been working on since wrapping up the five practices of a fruitful congregation sermon series that we gave earlier this year, if you were with us. And finally, next weekend is a fifth Sunday, and that means that we will be having a special opportunity to give to the Florida United Methodist Children's Home. We do this every time there's a fifth Sunday on the calendar, and there'll be a link under the Giving tab on our Lake Deaton at Home website that you can click on to give your regular offering as well as a special offering to the Children's Home. And speaking of special offerings, I know that you've all heard about the devastation in Haiti and the unrest that's been ongoing in Cuba. And this weekend, we're taking up a special offering to aid our brothers and sisters in these areas. And you will see that link this weekend online under the giving link on our website. That's all the announcements I have today. So let's go ahead and pray, and then we will get ready for the rest of the service. Gracious God, we thank you so much for this day and this chance for us to worship together, scattered about all over the place. There are those of us who are watching in New York and in the Midwest and here in Florida and in all different places in different communities. And we just ask that you would gather us all together now in this time of worship, no matter when it is or where it is. We thank you, Lord, for all the things that have gone well this week. And Lord, we also come to you with those things that have not gone well this week. And we lay those things in front of you and we give them over to you. And Lord, we especially pray for the people of Haiti and the earthquake that they've experienced and then the devastation of that being followed up by a tropical storm. Lord, we just ask that you would help to send resources to that area and that you'd remove barriers that might be in place and that you'd cut through red tape that might be there. And we ask, Lord, that you'd put it on our hearts to find a way to help in that area as well. And we pray today for Pastor Jim, who's going to give our service, our sermon here, both at Lake Deaton at Home and also the in-person services this weekend. We ask that you would be with him and that you would make his words into your words and that you'd open up all of our ears to hear the message that is proclaimed. We ask all of this in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Last weekend was David's last time with us, and it's very sad to have seen him go, but Rick and the band are going to bring us some beautiful music in just a moment, and Rick's going to be with us as our interim worship leader until we find just the right person to fit the needs of Lake Deaton. And so before we go to them, though, we are going to watch a short video about the Children's Home, so be blessed.
Your generosity. These items will be wonderful for the kids to use for their point store. The point store is like a reward for the kids earning points for signatures that they receive for following instructions, accepting feedback. So all the skills they're trying to learn, and then they get to pick items that are enjoyable and reinforcing to them that they're asking for. So we appreciate all your generosity and all your help and everything for making this so important in the kids' lives. Thank you.
Throughout my whole life, I always had people that were taking care of me, but not necessarily parenting me. I came to the children's home when I needed emergency placement. I ended up with really lovely house parents that had kids of their own. They were involved in seeing us succeed in our lives. We baked cookies. and I know that sounds silly, but it's things that you do in a regular home, and they did everything to make sure that we had the same experience here. From day one, I met with a counselor, and that was huge. It saved me. Without them and having an outlet and someone to work through everything that I had been through in my life, I probably wouldn't have been as successful. And that was talked to a lot to me throughout my entire time at the children's home is, I know that things are really hard right now, but please understand that God has a plan for you. And even, you know, I'm almost 30 now, and I still say that same saying to myself every day when things happen. I know it's hard right now, but God has a plan for you. I want to say thank you for everything that you do for the children's home. Without your support and donations, I would not be where I am today. The children's home gave me a second chance at living my best life, and I have done that. I am successful because of you and the support that you give in the children's home. So thank you.
Hello, we'd like to thank you for joining this edition of Lake Deaton and Home. Please worship with us as we go to our God in song. We waited for this day, we're gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our prayer. Presence in this place, your glory on our face, looking to the sky. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now, Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here, you're the reason we're singing. See you, open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our prayer. We want to see you open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Open up the floodgates. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise.
It's hard to believe that we're at the end of our summer series on worship. During the past 2 months, we have looked at the four load-bearing walls that make up the main components of worship. We started with the gathering, which is everything that happens from the second we walk in the door up until moving into the Word. The gathering is all about the mortal coming into the presence of the immortal, the finiteness of our human condition mingling with the infinite God of the universe. It is a time for centering ourselves and preparing ourselves to hear the Word. From the gathering, we transition into the Word, which is the proclamation of the story of God into the lives of humanity. We read Scripture, exposit the Scripture, not for deeper knowledge, but for deeper relationship. From the Word, we move into the table of the Lord, which is our response to the Word. It is the gift of God to help us renew our covenant that was made not by anything that we do, but by the work of Jesus Christ, who was fully God and fully human, and who completed the work of salvation, reconnecting between humanity and God. It is also a time for us to declare our hope, our faith, and our future firmly in Jesus Christ, crucified, buried, and raised on the third day, and not on anything else. Finally, we end the service with the sending, where we are sent through a benediction out into the world to live out Christ and to ultimately bring healing to the nations. Onto these four load-bearing walls that form a house, we've added the elements of prayer, music, and the Christian calendar. These three elements take the walls that have produced a house and make them into a home, a community of faith, created to be a unique manifestation of Christ for a specific time and place. Literally, these three elements combine the global nature of God with the local. Through our voice, our instruments, our special calendar and events, through our unique styles, we make this global story, this meta-narrative of God's interaction, into a local story, a personal story. As we finish up this series, I find myself asking a question. What's it all about? Why do we go through this flow, this liturgical path, week in and week out, for months, years, even for many of us for decades that we've been doing this thing every single week at the most basic level. Scholars tell us that Christians go to church and participate in worship services to remember God, to worship the God of creation, and to be thankful for the sacrifice of Christ that provides our salvation. And really, this is pretty good. This is the heart of worship, remembering, praising, and giving thanks. But maybe it's not enough. If the totality of why I come to join with a group of people every week is simply to remember and be thankful, I'm not sure if it has the lasting power that's needed for a lot of people to keep coming back. And maybe this is why so many people have left the church over the past several decades. Is being a Christian and worshiping God simply an exercise in thanksgiving and praise? Author Jeffrey Barker says that worship is about praising God. He writes that as we worship, God is glorified. But he offers more. He continues that as God is glorified, we are changed from one degree of glory into another. There is a story in the Gospel of John where Jesus comes upon a well near the village of Sychar. As he and his disciples are walking through the region of Samaria. As the disciples go into the village to buy some food, Jesus stays by the well, and a Samaritan woman comes to draw water. Many of you know this story, and if you don't, I encourage you to read John chapter 4 sometime today or in the next couple days. I'm not going to focus on all the details of this beautiful story, but I want to focus on one thing important for answering our question. As the woman talks with Jesus, she moves from a place of brokenness and separation into a place of transparency. She does this by admitting to another human being her history, her pain, ultimately her sin. She comes before Jesus transparent. Finally, she comes to a place of wholeness as she understands Christ to be the King and runs off to bring the healing she's received into the lives of others within her village. At the core of this story, we find Jesus clarifying for the woman the true meaning of worship. Beginning in verse 23, Jesus tells the woman, "But the time is coming, it has in fact already come, when what you're called will not matter and where you go to worship will not matter. It's who you are and the way you live that count before God. Your worship must engage your spirit in the pursuit of truth. That is the kind of people the Father is looking out for. Those who are simply and honestly themselves before Him in their worship. God is sheer being itself, spirit. Those who worship Him must do it out of their very being, in their spirits, their true selves in adoration." The woman had been asking Jesus about why the Jews insisted on worshiping one place and in one way, while the Samaritans worshiped in another way in another place. And Jesus tells her that it doesn't matter where you worship. He's really telling her that it doesn't matter what group you belong to. What matters is your life, that you are living your life transparently, truthfully, before a living God. Years ago, I was informed by the worship leader from a former church that our son Jonathan, who was still attending that church and who was paid to play the bass in the praise band most Sundays, did not ever turn in a timesheet when he played for the Celebrate Recovery Ministry on Friday nights. The worship leader couldn't figure out why Jonathan didn't charge for playing at Celebrate Recovery. So the next time I was with Jonathan, I asked him about it and was informed that he didn't feel like he could charge for his time in CR, Celebrate Recovery, because it appeared to him to be real worship. When I asked him what he meant by that, he told me that when he watched the people at CR, they seemed to be totally real and transparent before God. They were not playing a game or doing something that they had to do out of obligation, but they were just broken people coming together before a loving God. And I think this is what Jesus is saying to the woman at the well. He is sharing with her that as she comes authentically before God in worship, broken, battered, spirit open to the full spirit of Christ, she was coming in true worship. Wherever that might be, whatever community she found herself in, it's about the spirit which we each have within us, actively engaging with the Holy Spirit. The most powerful line of Jesus' declaration is this. He said to the woman, "Your worship must engage your spirit in the pursuit of truth." Jesus continues and tells her that God is spirit, and that to worship God, we have to, as true selves in adoration, open our spirit to interact with his spirit, the Holy Spirit. What Jesus is talking about here is getting to the real heart of our corporate worship. The founder of the Methodism, John Wesley, called this the means of grace. When we authentically put ourselves in a place of praise and worship, we get the benefit of the reciprocal God action of grace, and that grace working within us to bring transformation. So when we come together to sing songs of praise, to pray, to participate in the table of the Lord, when we do it simply fully engaged with God in worship, these are the means of grace. These major components of worship and these added elements, they're gifts of God given to allow us, mortal beings, to interact with the immortal. All of this is leading to something. It's leading to transformation. It's not just about remembering. It's about transformation, that we begin to take on the image of Christ. Paul calls it the mind of Christ, that we're called to have the mind of Christ. So let's go back for a second to the statement I read earlier from Jeffrey Barker. He said, as we worship, God is glorified and we're changed from one degree of glory to another. That's that transformation. But then he continues, then receiving the benediction, we're sent out into the world as Christ's body, priest, serving our God and our Father, bringing the healing of God to the nations. Brothers and sisters, worship is the central act of community. When, as a family of Christ, we center ourselves week in and week out on Jesus Christ. As we honestly come before Christ, glorifying God through worshiping Christ, opening our spirits to his spirit, we are putting ourselves under the means of grace so that we can be transformed into the image of Christ, that we can then go out into the world around us and bring Christ's love and witness the transformation of our neighborhood and our cities and our world. That's what it's all about. And that's why we worship. That's why we have these wonderful components and elements of worship. Let's pray. Lord God, I praise you for this day, for your word. I praise you for these elements that you give us, that as we come authentically before you, as we come transparently before you as your children and just open ourselves up to you, that this time of bringing glory, of bringing worship and thanksgiving to you leads to something more. It leads to transformation. It leads towards sanctification, which is having Christ in us, so that we can then take Christ to the world, that we can take you to the world to serve the world in love. And I praise you for that, Lord God, in Christ's name, amen. You know, we're gonna transition right now into a time of communion. And I wanna encourage you, you're at home, and all these aspects of worship, the gathering, the word, the table of the Lord and the sending are just as real and just as connected, whether we're doing this virtually through the internet or through the computer, and that we're connected globally as if we are all in the same room. And at the center of this, where the service leads, is to this one event, this event of the table of the Lord, where we come back to this place every week and we recenter ourselves on the foundation of our Christian walk, which is that our hope is in Jesus Christ. So I want to encourage you right now to get some sort of bread and drink, whatever it may be. Today, I'm using just a little roll, and I got some juice in this cup. And it could be whatever you'd like. The other day, I did it with a cracker and water. So whatever you have on hand, I encourage you to get and to join in this service as we center ourselves on Jesus. So as we begin this time, I remind you of the story of Christ, that God, in the fullness of time, sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to earth to redeem the nations, to restore the relationship that had been broken between the Father and humanity. And as Jesus came to the end of his ministry, as he prepared for the final days, he sat down with his disciples and he took bread, just a simple meal of the people. And as he sat there with his friends, he blessed the bread. He broke the bread into pieces and he said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you." Right now at home, if you're there, I invite you to take the bread and to just eat it, to remember what God has done for you, that God has given himself for you fully so that you can fully have Christ in your life. After the meal, Jesus took the cup and he blessed it and he gave it to his friends and he said, "Drink of this, all of you, for this is my blood poured out for the forgiveness of sins. So when you come together, eat of the bread and drink of the cup and remember me." So right now, I invite you to take your cup and to just take a drink. As you do that, remember that this cup, whatever it is you're drinking right now, it represents Christ's blood, which was shed for you. And that everyone's been invited to this table. It's an open table that anybody can come to. Even going back to that woman, the Samaritan woman, a broken woman, everybody's accepted at the dinner of Jesus Christ. And all we have to do to accept it, all we have to do is to receive the gift, is accept the gift, to come, to eat, to drink, and to let Jesus come into our life through his Holy Spirit and bring transformation. So we praise God for that today. I thank you so much for this time. And I ask that we would now just pray that the Lord would bless this meal that we've just taken. Lord God, we've joined together. We've heard your word, and now we've centered on your table. We've partaked in your body and your blood. We pray that as we've done that, as we've remembered, we've also relived and been renewed by your grace, that we are becoming more like you every day. In Christ's name, amen. Amen. Thank you. It's been wonderful to be with you all today. I just am so excited about this Lake Deaton at home, and that we can join together as a community and worship the Lord in this way. And I pray Lord's blessings on you today and as we continue to worship right now. Amen.
Thank you, Jim, for sharing that very special message with us. Please join us once again as we go to the Lord in song.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord our God. Then on the third and break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trample death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ our King. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord our God. We shall return in robes of white, the blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
That you have enjoyed worshiping with us here at Lake Deaton at Home. And we want to thank you for letting us come into your homes. It has been our honor and a blessing. I do want to remind you to make sure that you've taken some time to fill out our online connection pad. Again, you can find it on our Lake Deaton at Home website, www.lakedeatonathome.com. And if you have a need, a prayer request, or want to contact us, that contact information is also on that website. We encourage you to give us a call, email us, or contact us via the prayer section of the website anytime. We want to connect with you. And now go in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and have a wonderful week. And we hope we see you back here next time. Bye-bye, everybody.